بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who always bestows his mercy upon his servants. The one amongst his mercy upon his servants always to put them through stations where he gives them messages and indicators to bring them back to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So among those famous or most important stations in which he triggers our minds and our thoughts to go back to him is the station of Ramadan. And the most wise amongst us, the believers, is the one who tries his best to practice Allah's commands in this blessed month to the best that he can. And among the means in which the one can perfect his ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to seek knowledge and to master all the issues pertaining the practices that he needs to maintain during the month of Ramadan. And certainly, to do that before the beginning of any act of worship, it is something that brings the one closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Since he subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ Fairly, those who fear Allah most are the most learned ones, the most knowledgeable ones. So that's why to get the best out of Ramadan, the only meaning to that is knowledge. By pursuing it, striving hard to maintain it, and working to the best that you can in order to receive it and enrich that level of knowledge. So inshallah ta'ala, through this course we'll try to go over most of the important rulings that we need to learn and understand in order to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best that we can according to the sunnah of his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let us start from the very beginning, and usually the ulama, whenever they start with any chapter or book of fiqh, they usually start by defining that issue or that matter of the chapter. So since we're talking about fasting, let us start with the definition of fasting. The ulama, they say, usually when it comes to definitions, the scholars, they look into the linguistic definition first, and then they look into the legitimate definition of that title of the subject. So as-siyam, linguistically speaking, is al-imsak, meaning abstaining, to abstain. So to abstain from anything, it's classified as fasting, siyam. Whether you abstain from food or even talking, like in the case of when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, since the definition of abstaining can even include abstaining from speech. Like in the case of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Maryam, فَقُولِي إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيَ Say, I have made obligatory as a vow upon myself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not a fast, a siyam, not to speak or talk to anyone. So in her case, she was fasting from talking. So again, this applies to the linguistic meaning of as-siyam, to abstain from speaking. Also, we have an example from the Arabic language in a line of poem said by an-nabigha al-dibyani, when he said, خَيْلٌ صِيَامٌ وَخَيْلٌ غَيْرُ صَائِمَةٍ. He said, some horses are fasting, practicing siyam, and some horses are not practicing siyam. تحت العجاجة وأخرى تعلق اللجمة. He said, in a battlefield, and other horses are ready with the bridles upon their faces for the war. So he classified the horses of three types. One category are abstaining, meaning from fighting. They are put aside from fighting. The second category are in the battlefield fighting. The third category, having the bridles on their faces, ready to go into the battlefield. So the word siyam, it is used in the Arabic language to mean to abstain. While legitimately speaking, as-siyam, like the ulama defined it, huwa at-ta'abbudu lillah, to do it as an act of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by al-imtina' an al-sharab wa-ta'am wa-sa'ir al-mufattirat min turu' al-fajri ila shuruq ila ghurub al-shams. Salam tabarakatuh. Morning, brothers. So again, to do it as an act of worship by abstaining from food, drinks, and all the types of the invalidators of fasting from dawn until sunset. So this is the legitimate definition of fasting. Here in this definition, we need to understand some of the points regarding the definition. How do we know the Fajr time? If we are in a place where we cannot hear the adhan, or there is no sign for us as timing or schedules that shows us the beginning of Fajr time, how can we ourselves learn that this is the beginning of the Fajr time? The ulama, they say that there is al-fajr al-kadhib and al-fajr al-sadiq. There is the false Fajr and there is the true Fajr. The false Fajr almost half an hour before the true Fajr. It is before the true Fajr. Okay? The difference between the two is the false Fajr, which is before the true Fajr, is a light which comes from the east toward the middle of the sky. Okay? It's like a straight line. And after a while, it disappears. While the true Fajr is a light which comes from the east and goes toward the middle of the sky and spreads over the horizon from the east side. So there is a spread of light in the horizon from the east side where the sun is. Unlike the false Fajr, there is no spread of the light over the horizon. The false Fajr, after it becomes darkness. While after the true Fajr, the light keeps spreading and spreading until the sun rises. So there is no darkness coming after the beginning of the spread of the light in the Fajr, the true Fajr time. So this is the two differences between the two Fajr. The first Fajr, which is the false Fajr, it may seem like the beginning of the Fajr time, but it is called the false Fajr. When the false Fajr appears, we should not refrain from eating or drinking or enjoying ourselves. We only refrain and abstain from doing that once the true Fajr signs appears. Once it appears, then we abstain from drinking and eating and the remaining invalidators of fasting. So this is to distinguish between the Fajr al-Kadhib, the false Fajr, and the true Fajr. Also, regarding the sunset al-Maghrib, how do we know that this is the time for us to break our fasting? The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, like in the hadith of Umar in Bukhari and Muslim, he said, إِذَا أَقْبَلَ اللَّيْلُ مِنْ هَا هُنَا, and he pointed to the east, if the night comes from this direction, وَأَدْبَرَ النَّهَارُ مِنْ هَا هُنَا, and the night and the day went away from this side, meaning the west, فَقَدْ أَفْطَرَ الصَّائِمُ. So if the night comes from the east and the day starts to go away from the west, فَقَدْ أَفْطَرَ الصَّائِمُ, then the sign, the one who's fasting, should break his fasting. And the ulama say regarding this issue that if somebody is sitting in an area, in a flat area where he can see through the horizon the sun, once the entire sun disk disappears, sets, then he can break his fasting. So he should wait until the complete sun disk disappears and then he can break his fasting. If somebody is living in an area where there are buildings or there are mountains, like Al-Imam An-Nawawi said in Al-Majmu' that if the sun rays disappears from the top of the mountains, from the summits of the mountains, then you can break your fasting in this regard. Because in a mountainous area, the sun usually disappears at an early time, right? So how can I get an indicator that the sun had already finished set and this is the time for Maghrib for me? If I see that the summits of the mountains in the eastern side, there are no rays reflecting from the west side upon those mountains. This is an indicator for me that the sun had disappeared and I can break my fasting in this case. So again, the hadith of Umar in Bukhari and Muslim, if the sun, إِذَا أَقْبَلَ اللَّيْلُ مِنْ هَا هُنَا, if the night comes from this side, وَأَدْبَرَ النَّارُ مِنْ هَا هُنَا, وَغَرَبَتِ الشَّمْسِ, and the sun sets, فَقَدْ أَفْطَرَ الصَّائِمُ, then the sa'im should break his fasting. Done with the definition of الصيام, linguistically speaking and legitimately speaking. What is the ruling of fasting? As we all know, fasting is one of the five pillars of Islam. And this is mentioned in the very famous hadith of Jibreel in Sahih Muslim, when the Prophet Jibreel came to him in a form of a man. And then he asked him, أخبرني عن الإسلام, tell me about Islam. And he said the five pillars of Islam, أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة وتصوم رمضان. وتحج البيت إن استطعت إليه سبيلا. So he said to do that. Also we have the famous hadith of Ibn Umar in Bukhari and Muslim. بني الإسلام على خمس. Islam is based upon five pillars or five poles. And he mentioned صوم رمضان, to fast رمضان. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states before that in the Quran, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. All you who believe, verily صيام has been prescribed upon you, like is prescribed upon those before you, so that you may be dutiful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is proof from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it is written upon us, prescribed upon us. And another proof from the ayah after this ayah is فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. Whomever amongst you witnesses the month, then he should fast. So this is a clear command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we should fast the month of Ramadan. And of course, since it is an obligatory act amongst the pillars of Islam, if anyone denies that fasting is obligatory, he is classified as a disbeliever in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if he accepts the remaining pillars of Islam. So anyone denies any act of worship which has been proven in the Quran and the Sunnah that it is obligatory, this act of his makes him a disbeliever in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone denies that fasting is obligatory, we say this is an act of disbelief, and this guy had disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be aware of this. So as-siyam, it is proven that it is wajib and fard by the Quran, the Sunnah, and the ijma', the consensus of the ulama. Since the Sahaba time until our time, all the ulama agreed that this is a must, a fard from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fast the month of Ramadan. And certainly, we all know about the virtues of fasting and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had distinguished this specific act of worship from many other acts of worship. Like in the hadith of Abi Huraira in Sahih Muslim, when he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كُلُّ عَمَلِ ابْنِ آدَمْ لَهُ الْحَسَنَةُ بِعَشْرِ أَمْثَالِهَا إِلَى سَبْعِمِائَةِ ضِعْفٍ إِلَّا الصَّوْمْ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِبِهِ. He said, all the deeds of the son of Adam are multiplied from 10 hasanat, 10 rewards, up to 700 rewards. Except for fasting, it is for me, and I reward for it. يَدَعُ طَعَامَهُمْ وَشَرَابَهُمْ وَشَهْوَتَهُمْ for my sake, لي. So that's why he leaves his food and drink and desire for my sake. So this is why it became more rewardable than any other act. Fasting, in reality, You may pretend before people that you are fasting, but once you are alone, you can go and break your fasting, and nobody would see you. So that's why when you abstain from drinking and eating during Ramadan, whether you are in the open or you are secluded, locked up to yourself in a room, you are, Allah sees that. And once He sees it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He rewards greatly for that. He knows it is sincerely done for Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also among the virtues of fasting is like the hadith of Abi Huraira in Bukhari, he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, إِذَا دَخَلَ رَمَضَانَ فُتِّحَتْ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ وَغُلِّقَتْ أَبْوَابُ النِّيرَانِ وَسُلْسِلَةَ الشَّيَاطِينِ. If the Ramadan enters, the doors of paradise are wide open and the door of Jahannam is closed and the shayateen are put into chains. This means that Allah is helping people to come back to Him. He's giving them a help to come back to Him. That's why we do see a big difference between Ramadan and the other months of the entire year. We see people are coming more to the masajid, right? In Ramadan, we see people even praying the optional salah, not only the obligatory salah. Unlike the remaining days of the year, we do see people, in many cases, not coming that much to the masajid. This is a help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving them a push to come toward Him and to increase their iman and to make it as a beginning for them to change their lifestyle and to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, the virtues are so many regarding fasting the month of Ramadan. And we also know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, like in the hadith al-Qudsi, that He has in every day of Ramadan, utaqa min al-nar. He frees people from hellfire. Meaning that if anyone is freed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the month of Ramadan from hellfire, he shall never enter it. Allah gives him like a guarantee that this person will never enter hellfire. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those whom He frees from hellfire.